Welcome to another setup with Ashes Corner Youth Group. Today we are joined by Mark Duker. I hope I pronounced your last name correctly, otherwise correct me. And he's gonna teach us about Azure Functions, hopefully. As a small intro, since you know we're going global, so to say, Azure Skåne is a small user group in southern part of Sweden. The agenda is, of course, a welcome and intro. It doesn't take 15 minutes, but that's what we set up. Maybe we have some time to fix the live stream that's not working. And then we're going to hear about creating an Azure Functions updates Twitter bot. So that's going to be interesting. So a little bit about Azure Skåne. Today we are over 940 members, so that's nice. It's all about learning, networking, and having fun. Everyone is welcome, regardless if you have any knowledge of Azure or not. You know, just join the fun and network and enjoy. The Azure Skåne crew, it's me. My name is Michael. I'm an Azure MVP, and I work for Avanade Denmark. Live in Sweden. We have Magnus Mortensson. He's also a Microsoft Azure MVP and a regional director. And then we have Johan. Maybe you could mention something.
Yeah, so my name is Johan, and I worked with Azure since it was in beta version 2009. So a lot has happened since that time. And I've been working for some large companies and some smaller companies, and now I'm running my own company, so I can do whatever I find the most fun.
That's a good privilege. Yeah. If I continue just quickly, since I know we are joined by people that's not only present in Azure, Skåne, in the southern part of Sweden, that is. So here is a small picture. So now you know where we're based. It's the small red dot here. Actually, it should be moved a little bit close to Denmark. If you want to know what Skåne is famous for, we have a pretty cool building, turning torso. We have an awesome bridge connecting us to Denmark. And you can see in the picture, it actually goes underwater for 3 kilometers. So that's pretty cool. Yeah, in the pandemic times, you know, we fight this pandemic together. So the bridge has been lit up in solidarity a couple of times. The self-proclaimed best soccer player in the world is from Malmö, Zlatan Ibrahimovic. Absolute Vodka is distilled not far from Malmö. It's in Skåne at least. Aarhus is the place. But you have to travel across the world to buy it cheap. You can buy it cheap in Sweden. We also have a data center in Staffanstorp. Actually, it should be like that. And at least that's what Skåne is famous for. We probably have some other stuff, but that's the crucial parts. We would really appreciate if you're attending any of our sessions or if you interact with us somehow, please use the hashtag Azure Skåne. We deleted the O because it's not used globally, but Azure Skåne is the hashtag. And if you tweet, LinkedIn, Facebook, whatever you use, please let us know with using this hashtag. It would be really appreciated. And today's sponsors, Microsoft usually sponsors, and Food Cafe is always helping us in the mix. And currently, they have some live streaming issues. Could be the big Fastly outage. We don't know yet. But thanks to the sponsors, we have a digital badger. Hopefully, you know what that is. You can claim these badgers if you attend any training sessions or if you contribute to the community. You could get a content hero or community hero badge. So if you, of course, we actually haven't received that one yet. So next time we will give that to you. But it's a cool Badger thing that you can look up. If you go to akams.com/AsherHeroes, you can read up on it. It's a really nice thing that Microsoft has created here, together with Engine, I guess. But this one we have, Discord. We have an AsherScone Discord, and we started it some time ago to keep us more connected in this remote times. So if you join this Discord, you can interact with us more. There's some chatter going on in the channels, and there's a lot of good content being pushed in the Azure resources sections, and we have some updates on good videos and stuff. So it's a really good go-to place if you're working with Azure in general or IT in general. So feel free to join that one by using this link or scan the QR code on the picture. So with that, let's get started. I'm going to hand it over to you now, Mark, and then I'm going to enjoy the show.
Perfect. Thanks. Let's start by sharing my screen. It's always exciting how quick Teams will respond with these things. Yeah, almost there. Yeah, there we go. All right, you should be able to see my slides now. So yeah, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me for AsherScone. And I'd like to, I always love to talk about the Azure Functions, but specifically one of my best projects, that's the Azure Functions Update Twitter bot, which I created quite a while ago. Let's see what's on the menu. Okay, first about me. My name is Mark Duiker. So you pronounced my last name quite well, actually. I'm from the Netherlands. It's really super sunny and warm here at the moment. I'm now here in my attic, and it's 25 degrees already, so it's really quite warm. So it seems we have quite an early summer here. I'm a consultant for Xperit, and I do a lot of stuff with Azure, and especially with serverless. I'm also an Azure MVP, and I do quite a bit for the community. And one of my recent projects is Azure Functions University, where I create quite some content for people new to Azure Functions. And I don't do it just by myself. There are quite some other people who are helping me out with this content. So if you want to learn about it, definitely go to it. I'll share a link a bit later. But also if you want to participate and help me create content, I could definitely use a hand there as well. So next to the tech stuff, I also like to draw pixel art. I draw this figure here. Also during MS Build, I also drew all of the hosts. So that's definitely another one of my side projects. And in general, I think people ask me, what is my hobby? I think my hobby is to have hobbies, because I like a lot of different things. So this is what we're going to talk about. So this is the Twitter account of the Azure Functions update. It exists since January 2019, so that's well over 2 years already. And it posts updates in the form of this. So whenever something new is released on GitHub, it will post a tweet containing what the repo name was, what the version is, and when the exact date of publishing was, and a link so you can actually go to the release to read more about it. So I'm going to take a more or less a waterfall approach on this presentation, going from idea, design, development, then we'll switch to VS Code and how it's running in production. So how did I get started with this idea? Well, I've been using Azure Functions from day one, and the development experience wasn't really the best in the beginning. So I was building some kind of prototype, again, one of my side projects. I would leave it for a couple of days. I would come back, update some packages, and then stuff would break. And of course, I wasn't very happy when it happened. And so of course, man, when things are still in preview, things like that happen. But still, I wanted to know why is software breaking, and usually that's because, well, one thing was upgraded, but that also meant that I had to upgrade one another thing. So things were quite a bit dependent on each other, which caused for this less ideal development experience. Things have improved really quite a bit on to this date, so it's definitely not as bad anymore now. Sometimes you still need to be a bit fiddly, especially when we have support for different runtimes now. So you have Azure Functions for .NET 5, but also still for .NET Core 3.1. But this was my situation I was in, and I didn't like it. And that's because the Azure Functions ecosystem is really big. There are so many moving parts. So currently, the Twitterbot is tracking a lot of different sources. Just an overview of most of the things I'm tracking. So these are all GitHub repositories related to Azure Functions. And you can see there's the Azure Functions core tools, but there's also a lot of stuff split for .NET or for JavaScript and for Python. You don't need to be up to date for all of them, because if you only work in Python, then you only need to know about the Python things. But I did want to make a solution that would be usable for every developer in every language. So this is my use case. So as a developer, I want to be notified of new releases in order to stay up to date. So let's have a look at the design and some of the choices I made to create this Twitterbot. So some choices need to be made. First, what would be the source of the information I would base the notifications on? Very briefly, I looked at Azure because one of my colleagues from Experience also created Twitterbot quite some time ago, and he posts updates about AKS releases, but he looks at Azure to determine what version of AKS is running in Azure. And sure, that works for that situation, but that doesn't work for my situation, because a lot of the Azure Functions extensions are just packages you load in your own code and then deploy them to Azure. There's not enough information in Azure to be aware of all of these new developments. So that didn't work. Then I thought, okay, maybe I just focus on NuGet and focus on just the .NET. As I mentioned before, I ideally wanted to create a solution that would work for all languages and not just for .NET. So I also skipped NuGet. So I end up with GitHub, because all of the work is done in open source related to Azure Functions. So everything is on GitHub, is publicly available, and most of the teams and repositories do mark their releases. Not all of them do, unfortunately, but most of the release information is available there. So that's perfect. So then the delivery of the notifications. So initially I was thinking about, should that be send emails? But people then need to leave their email and they need to subscribe, and maybe they also want to unsubscribe and stuff like that. So I felt that would be a bit of too much hassle. So in the end, I chose for Twitter. Most of the technology community is also on Twitter. So it's a very low barrier, and people can follow the account or they won't, and that's also fine. And integrating with Twitter was actually not so hard. Then storage. So I'm getting information from GitHub, and I'm posting information to Twitter. But then when there is something new from GitHub, then I need to compare what I posted to Twitter. So I need to store what I've retrieved earlier from GitHub and what I've been posting to Twitter. So I need to know when things are new enough and I don't post the same information again. So I need to store some information. I was working at that time also with Cosmos DB, which I really liked, but I ended up with table storage because it's super simple to use, but also then the most cheap option. If I would do it now again, I would probably choose for Cosmos DB because there is a serverless option for now for Cosmos DB. So it's fully on demand. But over 2 years ago, that option was not available yet. Then the runtime. Logic apps for Azure Functions. I was really quick about this decision because it's of course very nice to have something tweeting and running on Azure Functions, if it's also about the updates on Azure Functions. But since we're dealing with GitHub and we're dealing with the Twitter API, those are excellent points which can also be very easily, or I think even easier, integrated in Logic Apps than Azure Functions. So I think what I built in Azure Functions is also possible with Logic Apps. Okay, I see some questions. I can answer them right now. So the table storage option now was primarily cost, because CosmosDB was only available as a certain proficient RUs, and yeah, I wouldn't use a lot, but yeah, I didn't want to have a lot of cost incurred there, because I would only use it very little, and yeah, table storage is really super cheap. So cost was the main driver there. Okay, so my design, or at least all my decisions for technology were made. So then I decided, okay, what kind of information will I need to model and what do I need to store? So I've come up with a couple of domain models for this situation. So first, I need to capture which GitHub repositories I need to query. So I need to have a list somewhere which just lists the names of the repositories and also the owners of the repositories in order to query them, because I am not doing just a big search for Azure Functions and just query everything. No, I have a fixed list that I will search for every time. The other domain model I have is called a repository release, and that is the release information I get from GitHub, but a bit trimmed down. Because when you query GitHub, we'll see it later, you get back a lot of information. I only need some information about the version number, the release date, the created date, stuff like that. So these two things I'm storing in table storage. Next to that, I've got two more models, which just exist in memory. I'm not storing them. One is called latest releases. So that's more like a helper class, which contains a reference to the GitHub release and a reference to the historical release I've saved in my table storage. And I can ask this object from, okay, is this GitHub release, is it newer, is it more recent than I've saved in my history class, history table? And if so, then you should save it again and then you should post it to Twitter. So it's more like a convenience object. The last model I have is the update message, and that contains information that's required when I want to push the message to Twitter. All right. So I need to do a couple of things. So I wrote this quickly on paper. Then I moved it to PowerPoint and using it in the slide. But I have a workflow. And that's why Logic Apps would also be a good fit here, I think. But I'm using Azure Functions, but there is also a very nice extension on top of Azure Functions that's called Durable Functions. And with Durable Functions, you can also create workflows. But instead of a visual designer where you just click and drag and configure stuff, you write your workflow in code. So you write function calls that refer to other functions, so-called activity functions. And those are all the orange boxes here. Those are activities. And in your orchestration, you'll define what the order is you call these functions. And some of the functions you will call in sequence, and some you can call concurrently. But this is the high-level design of the application. So if you start at the top left, it's timer triggered, so it runs every 2 hours. The first step you do then is we get our repository configurations from table storage. So this contains the names of the repositories. So I think it's around 40, 45 different repositories at the moment. And then for each of the repositories, we will query GitHub to get the latest release information of it. And for the same repositories, we'll also query what we have in our historical data model. Then we will do a comparison using this latest releases object. And based on that, we determine if we have something new, and if so, we will need to save it. And if it is saved, we will also post it to Twitter. Talking about Durable Functions in specific, I have separate talks where I go very deep in Jupyter Functions and how it works. But on a very high level, you have three different function types when you use Jupyter Functions. The first one is the client function. And the responsibility of the client function is to start a new instance of an orchestrator. And client function is just a regular triggered function. So it could be an HTTP trigger or a queue trigger. But in this case, it's a timer-based trigger. So this timer trigger, this is the client function. And the client function then starts an orchestrator function. And we don't see the orchestrator here, but the orchestration, the orchestrator function is actually a function that wraps all of these calls to the activity functions. And the activity functions then are these highlighted boxes. And that's the smallest unit of work which you can do. So it usually is just calling out to a database to get the configurations or making a request to GitHub or posting to Twitter. So those are the activities. And activity function should only do just one thing. All right, let's have a look at the actual code now. And this is actually the first time I'll do this presentation a bit differently, because before I would have screenshots of code and go through that. But now we will go to VS Code, because that's more and more my favorite editor these days, mostly because there's VS Code pets. So you can have very nice digital pets in your IDE. And of course, this is an Azure Functions related one. But I'll be using a different extension to guide you through the source code. So the extension is called CodeTour. And with CodeTour, you can create annotations and some kind of guidance, which actually, you can follow a step-by-step guidance through your application. So we'll be using that. I think there's a link at the end of the session to this GitHub repo, because you can also do this on your own. So when you clone the repo and open the folder in Visual Studio, it will recommend you to also install this extension. And when you've done so, and you go to this this navigation folder, you'll see this code tour panel here, which contains several steps. And let's start that. Let's start our code tour. So our first stop is at the client function, the timer triggered function. So that's this part. So in code tour, as you can see, inserts this markdown snippets right in your code. I can also collapse it. So now it's gone. I can show it again. But it's always about the row, the code mentioned the row above. When I'm talking about these things, just always look at the row above or the section above, and that's the point I'll be talking about. So this is our entry point of our application. We have a schedule here that's called every 2 hours. So then this application starts. There's some navigation here at the bottom, so we can proceed to our next step in the code tour. We are still in the same function, but then just a couple of rows lower. And here we see that the Jupyter client attribute is used. So that's how Jupyter Functions and the Azure Functions runtime knows this is a special type of function. And with that client, we have this interface, and that contains a method start new async. And that's the method you can use to start a new instance of your orchestrator. So you need to provide the name of the orchestrator and an input, if you have any. So in this case, we provided the name of the orchestrator that we want to run. So let's have a look at this release update orchestration. All right, so this is the orchestrator function. There is this orchestration trigger that's used. So that's how the runtime knows this is a special type of function, the orchestration function. And yet we have a special context here that is used to make calls to the activity functions. So now we're talking about the whole thing that wraps all of the calls to the various functions. Someone wants to also the code pets. Okay. So this code block above is the call to our first activity, and the activity is get POS3 configurations activity. So how does it work? You have this context, the double orchestration context, and that has several methods. And this method we're using here is call activity with retry async. So there are some very long method names in there, but they're very descriptive, so I actually quite like it. And how you should read this, we were going to call an activity, but also with some retry options. So we'll get to this shortly. And what we expect back is a read-only list with repository configurations. And so those will contain my repository names and owners, which I can then later on use to query GitHub. We didn't have to provide the function name. Again, using name of and then the name of the class, so it's sort of strongly typed. In the latest release of Jubal Functions, it's 2.5.0, and there's another way of calling activities and starting orchestrations, and that's fully strongly typed now. So there has been some improvements, so you don't need to use either strings or this name of syntax anymore. So we provide the name of the function, but we're also supplying some retry options. Well, why do we do that? In this case, we're calling out to some other servers. In this case, it's Azure servers because we're calling out to table storage. But there might be a hiccup somewhere, some kind of glitch in the network, and the call fails. If you don't call this function with the retry, because there's also a call activity without the retry, then this activity will fail. And that means also the orchestration will fail. So then everything comes to a halt. So by using the retry option, we can have Jubal Functions retry this activity if it fails. And you're in control how often you want to retry this and how many times and what the time span should be. I'm using a builder here, which just builds me a default instance of retry options. I think it retries 3 times and waits a couple of seconds. So it's very easy way to make your orchestration more resilient. You also need to provide an input for your activity function. In this case, my activity function doesn't require any input, so I just pass in null. All right, so let's have a look at this activity function now. So this is the first activity, the get repository configurations activity. So that's this one. And we can also see here that it uses a table binding. So here are 2 bindings used. First, the binding to indicate this is an activity, so it can be scheduled by the orchestrator. And the other one is a table binding. And in this case, we are using it as an input binding because we want to read the repository configurations from table storage. So if you go a few lines lower, I make a new result object called configurations. Then I build a query with the built-in query builder. And I want to return all of the records for a given partition key. And because this is my configuration, I only have a limited set of records configured there. So I will just, I want all the results for that partition key. Then that query is executed and it gives you back a query result. And then I apply a bit more filtering to only return the results that are active. Because initially I loaded up this table with more data, but I just wanted to process just a couple of them. So I just have a is active a property on it to make sure I can only be very specific in what configurations I want to load. Let me make this a bit bigger. In this screenshot here, you can see what's available in my table storage for configuration-wise. So my partition key is repositories. Then I have a row key that's a combination of the owner of the repository and the name of the repository. And then some timestamps and then some hashtags, which will be used in the Twitter post. Some is active. And I think that's it. Yeah. So now you only see the repositories as partition key, but I'm also having some other partition keys because it is the intention that this Azure Functions update will do more than just GitHub release updates. So there is still some work to be done there, but that is possible. So eventually this function returns all of the configurations from table storage. So now we're back in the orchestrator. So if the activity returns any data, so if there's something in my configuration, then I will continue. If not, then there's nothing to process, so we're done. So let's get to the next step. And the next step will get repository releases for both GitHub and my history table. So let's have a look at that. As you can see, I've used quite some smaller methods. So I don't have a very large orchestration class with all of the activity calls right in there. I have some other submethods in there to make sure the code is a bit more readable. All right, so what am I doing here? I will call the activities a bit later, but I'm doing it differently right now because I won't be calling the activities sequentially, because I just have a collection now of 40 plus repository configurations, and I need to call out both to GitHub and to my history table for all of these 40 configurations. And I don't want to do that sequentially because that will take very long, and it's we can do this more in a concurrent way. So what I'm doing here is I've defined two lists of type task GitHub repository release and task history repository release. And I will populate these lists of tasks. You will see that here. So here I'm iterating over my repository configurations. And here I'm populating the GitHub releases tasks. And here you see I am making the call activity with retry async, which calls out to an activity, in this case the get late release from GitHub activity. But I'm not awaiting this task. So what I'm doing here, I'm just creating the task, and the task will eventually call this activity, but I'm not executing the task yet. I'm just collecting the task. So for each of the 40 plus configurations, I'm collecting the task which will call out to GitHub, and I'm collecting the task which will call out to the history table. First, let's look into these activities individually, and then we come back to collect the results of these tasks. So this is the get latest release from GitHub activity. We see that it uses dependency injection, and we inject a iGitHub client. And if you have worked with GitHub before, you might know there's something like called OctoKit. And OctoKit provides some very nice client packages to communicate with the GitHub API. So if you ever need to do that, please use it. It is really user-friendly. It's there for C#, it's there for JavaScript, it's there for Ruby. I'm not sure if that's available for anything else, but it's a really very, very nice solution. And it's also very testable this way. So we're now in this task, which needs to get information from GitHub. All right, so this line, so this piece here, that does most of the work. So we use this OctoKit client, and we call dot repository dot release dot get all. And here we specify the name of the repository owner and the repository name. And that will get me all of the releases for this repository. And with all, I mean, I think the most recent 30 by default. And that's not for me. I then have some logic to determine what is the actual latest, most recent release. So I do some ordering by, and I do a bit of magic because there are actually different dates, a created date and a published date. And then I map the GitHub release, because this is a GitHub GitHub type, and match it to my own type, so the repository release. So that's what comes out of it. So initially, I didn't do it like this. Initially, I used the, let's see if it's there, get latest. Yeah, so initially I used the get latest method. So I thought, oh, this is great. I can just with one call, I can do a get latest, which just gives me the latest release for this repository. And yes, it gave me the latest release, but it didn't give me the latest release when it was a preview release. So I thought my code was functioning well. But in my case, I thought it was also publishing and tweeting about preview releases, but it didn't. So that's why I have to use the get all, since that returns both normal releases, but also preview releases. So that's one of those tiny things you only find out if you're working with it and if it's running for a while. Let's make a small sidestep and let's show the GitHub REST API in a bit more detail to see what kind of information comes back. So this file is also in the repository. It's a .http file. I'm not sure who knows about this, but I'm using yet another extension called the REST client. That's this one. And with that, you can use these .http files to create your to create your GET or POST or update requests and execute them straight from VS Code. So I can do send a request now, which makes this GET request to this URL, the API github.com/azure/azure functions/host/releases. So this will give me the same thing as the method I've shown you before. So let's make this call. Let's hope everything's working. Yes, it does. Okay, perfect. So it gives me back the response, lots of headers. But then there's a collection of, I think it's about 30, the latest releases, in this case, the Azure Functions host. So the thing that is running your Azure Functions. So it contains a lot of information, but I'm only using a handful of it. I think I'm storing the ID, I'm storing the tag name, I'm storing the name itself, and the created and published. I'm storing what else? Oh yeah, I'm also storing the body. So the body is actually a piece of Markdown that contains a description, usually contains some release notes. So I'm also storing it, although I'm not using it. Maybe in the future. If you do a lot of stuff with HTTP APIs, I definitely recommend to use the REST client to do some work. I mean, first I'm using Postman, which is of course still a great tool. I have hardly any use for Postman anymore. Now I use this REST client. Okay, now let's go to the other activity to return the historical releases, which I've saved from earlier runs. So that's this part. So, and it's very much like the other function, which returns the repository configurations because it uses a table input binding. And also here we'll see we'll use the query builder to create a query and execute it. And it just returns the latest, most recent created at result. I've also took a screenshot of what's currently in the history repository release table. I've sorted it by timestamp. So we'll see that the Azure Functions Python worker was one of the most recent releases just a couple of days ago. So this is the information I'm storing. I'm storing a bit more columns to the right, but this is the most important information. What was very striking for me to see that different teams use completely different naming rules for naming releases. As you can see here, some name it release and a number, some just have a number, and some have very long text in there. So it goes all over the place, which makes it sometimes very inconsistent. We're back in the orchestration now. And we have collected all of these tasks. So we now have a collection of tasks to call the GitHub release activity. And we have a collection of tasks to call the history releases. And with this syntax, so await task when all, and by providing all of the tasks here, here we instruct Drupal functions to execute all these tasks concurrently and only continue when all of them have completed. So what we first do, we first call out to GitHub and wait until they're all done. And then we call out to the table storage and return all this information. All right. Let's go to the next step, a couple of lines below. Again, I'm iterating over the repository configurations. And I'm using, again, a builder pattern, I'm quite fond of that, to build these latest release objects, which contain both a reference to the GitHub release information and the historical release information. And I'll be using this latest release objects later on in order to determine if things need to be saved and posted to Twitter. So this is the object itself, the latest release object. So I pass in the two different release objects that I've collected before. So I'm now talking about this step in the flow. And you see here, I have some methods to indicate, okay, is something new and should it be stored? And is something new and should it be posted? Okay, so we're back in the orchestrator now. So let's talk about this save latest release sub method. So first is check, okay, is this release, is it new and should it be stored? And because it might not be the case that it's of any value now, so then we don't do anything. But if it is new, then we will call out to the save latest release activity. So let's have a look at that. So in this case, we are talking about this function here, and yeah, its only responsibility is to just put something in table storage. And since this release is based on an entity which is suitable for table storage, what I do is simply return that GitHub repository release. And since I use this very weird return attribute syntax, we can use the table output binding here to simply put something in table storage. So yeah, I still find this syntax very strange, but it works like a charm. All right, we're back in the orchestration again, but now we're looking at the post latest release method. And we're not directly posting an update to Twitter immediately. So we'll only do it in a certain condition. And there are three sub-conditions that need to be verified. The first thing is I'm using a feature toggle. I only have this running in production, no test environment, whatever. But sometimes I like to mess around with my code a bit, but I want to make sure that nothing gets out to Twitter. So then I set this feature toggle to false. So I know everything can be stored and stuff like that, but I'm not calling Twitter. But normally this is set to true, so this one's fine. Then I'll ask my latest release object from, okay, is this saved already? So this field is set in the previous method. And if it's saved, then I will continue. If it's not saved, I don't want to post to Twitter. And because next time in 2 hours, the whole orchestration will run again. It will find this repository again. Then it will try to save this again, and then it would tweet it again as well. So I need some checks and balances to make sure I'm not doing any duplication. And finally, I check if is this new and should it be posted. This is also something I edit later, because initially I added maybe like 5 or 6 repositories and monitor that. But later on, I start adding more and more repositories. But for some repositories, maybe their latest release was a month ago, but then it would still be picked up by this application. But yeah, if something is released a month ago, then I think it has very little news value. So now I've made it a bit more intelligent, and now there's a time window of, I think, 7 days. And if the release has been done in the last 7 days, then I find it new enough to post to Twitter. So when this is all set, then I'll create the Twitter message. So I'm getting all the information from my GitHub release, building a message out of it. And then I'm calling the post update activity function. So let's have a look at that. Right, so this function is this bit over here that needs to communicate to Twitter. Well, I didn't have any experience with integrating with Twitter before, but I did find out that there's this very nice NuGet package from TweetInvy. I put the link in here. And this is quite straightforward to use. You do need to create a developer account for Twitter, and you need to fill in a form, and it needs to be approved, and you have to swear that you're a good person and you're not doing any harm to Twitter, et cetera, et cetera. But once that is approved, you can create your apps in there, and you get some keys and some tokens. So I put that in my app settings of my application. So I'm reading all these here in this function. So for that, I'm not using key vaults yet, which is a nice improvement point. But then the posting to Twitter only takes two lines. So the first line is creating a Twitter credentials, which takes all the information from the environment variables. And the second one is called execute operation with credentials. So you supply the credentials, and then it's tweet, publish tweet, and then the content of the message. So yeah, I was very happy that this tweet NV package was available there, because otherwise it would have cost me quite some effort to make this. So I'm having a lot of logging still in all these functions, and that's because initially sometimes stuff was failing. So I've put in quite some logging information and all of these things. I can definitely clean up now because it has been running quite smoothly for the last year. But I definitely run into the issue that sometimes the message of the tweet was too long. And I did not see that yet. So that's why I've built something on top of that. And that's this. So we see a try catcher. So if this post update activity fails, then it will go into the cache. And it will call another activity. And the responsibility of this activity is to put the content of the update message to put it on the queue. And I can go to the queue, I can expect the message and see what's wrong, hopefully, and then try to fix it. So this activity is also very tiny. It's the smallest activity there. It just takes the message as an input and it simply returns it. And because we use the return attribute for the queue output binding, it just puts it at the queue. So maybe in hindsight, because initially I showed you all the domain models and I was storing the update message. And now I am actually storing it in this data queue if things go wrong. But maybe when I redesign it completely, I should maybe store the update message or do at least a bit more validation to know what the length of the message is, although that part has been fixed now. Okay, so that was the code tour part. Let's do the slides. This one. All right. So all of the code's there, but how do we get to production? Well, the code is on GitHub. I mentioned it before, I think. The deployment is still in Azure DevOps. And that's because, when I created this 2+ years ago, I was most familiar with Azure DevOps. I don't think actions were even a thing back then, but it's still on my to-do list to actually move this to GitHub Actions, so I can finally let go of the Azure DevOps part. I think it's not even using the YAML-based pipelines. I think it's still using the classic pipelines. So that's definitely on my to-do list. But it still works fine. So that's why I didn't change it, because it's still working good. So let's talk a bit about running the stuff in production now. I've created this function app in Azure, and whenever I do whenever I merge a pull request, stuff is pushed to main, and the main branch is always published to Azure. And when you have stuff running in Azure and it's production, and you care about what's running in production, you should definitely use Log Analytics and Application Insights. This is the application map in Application Insights. And that gives you really quite a nice idea of what's going on. How does your application look like? What kind of services are you using? So in this case, we can see that we have my function app here, and I'm aggregating results over the last 24 hours. We can see that the Azure Functions has used 11 different instances, so different, let's say, VMs, to run my functions. And the 11 instances, it's depends. Sometimes it's 12, sometimes it's 11. But you might think it's a bit strange here because my code is being run every 2 hours. So if we look back 24 hours, you would expect maybe 12 instances. But sometimes instances are reused to run your code. So that's why it's 11 instances. But if things are failing, you'll see some red numbers here, and you can do a drill down to see what's failing. In this case, it's just very nice to you because you can see some aggregations, how many calls have been done, what were the average times. So it gives a very quick insight. But of course, you won't be monitoring the Azure portal day and night. So I would always suggest to set up some alerts. So in case something happens, you'll be notified either via an email like I did, or maybe via Teams, or you can choose whatever you want. But definitely set up alerting. And this is also something that is quite straightforward to do. And it's also very nice that you can be quite detailed in what kind of alerting you do and what the signal of your alert is. Because if you look at the right here, we are looking at failures of a single activity type that's failing. Yeah? So this is the post update activity. And we want to be notified when that fails. And that information is all out there in Log Analytics. So you just need to do a bit of configuration to choose your signal, then choose when you want to be notified. In this case, when the signal is greater or equal than the count of 3. Because since I'm using dual functions with these retry options, when an activity fails, it will be retried maximum 3 times. So if it just fails once or twice, then I'm still good. Then I don't want to have an alert. But if it fails 3 times, then it means something is really broken. So here you see a preview of the signal. So here we can see that last year in August, things were still wrong at times. This is just a very, very quick way to make sure that you can respond in a timely manner when things go wrong. Yeah, so this is a screenshot where I list some of the signals that you can use. So here you can see that this list contains all of the different activity functions, or also orchestrator functions or client functions that are available in the function app. So you can be really specific to what you want to alert for. And in this case, I want the most important thing that my function is doing is posted to Twitter. So I want to be alerted on that. But you might also be interested in average duration just before this session started. There was a question, okay, maybe I want to know about something. Is my duration increasing, or is it deviating from something? Or maybe you want to do alert on a certain count on a certain function. So there are a lot of signals available which you can do alerting on. So be aware of that and definitely configure that when you go to production. If you dig a bit deeper into the Log Analytics and also into the performance blade, then there's also a lot of information available about the performance of your function app. And again, you can look at the overall performance as is selected here, and you can see an average duration of this overall performance. So you can see that the overall performance, whenever a request comes in, within half a second, it's been processed on average. But as you can see down here, you can also look very specifically in certain client functions, how long are, what's the performance on those. And this is for your own operations. So these are different functions in your app. So tracking is when you make API calls to external parties. So what's the performance on those? And you can see when I do a call to GitHub, sometimes it takes over a second to get the result back. Just browsing through this data once in a while gives some very, very nice insights. Again, this is also information available in the performance blade, and this looks at the distribution of durations. And what this shows is, well, at the 50th percentile, so on average, calls are finished within 290 milliseconds, which is quite quick. And then there is a kind of a long tail, so there are some calls which take 3.4 seconds. We are looking at the overall statistics here. So this could be a call to an external thing, like it could be either Twitter or GitHub, which takes so long. You can definitely drill into that. On the right hand side, there's the specific release update orchestration. Again, that shows what the average is, how long this orchestration runs. It's very short. Again, there's some longer tail, but not as extreme as shown here. So the last time I gave this talk was about a year ago. So, and I was updating the slides, and I was also updating the charts. So the right-hand side is the slide we've seen before. So the left hand here is the right hand here, but the left side here is the data from a year ago. So I was looking at this and thought, wow, this distribution chart looks quite different. It's quite shifted to the left, which indicates that the performance has been improved over time, because the times are shorter in this year, 2021. And I think this is data aggregated over over a month or so. So there's a very broad peak here, and the 50th percentile is around 560 milliseconds. So that was last year, but this year the 50th percentile is 290 milliseconds. So I'm very much intrigued to get a bit more details on why this is happening, because I think partly, I guess the performance of Azure Functions is improving, but since we're looking at the overall distributions, it could also be that HTTP calls maybe are shorter. So I need to apply a bit more filtering to make sure that I'm only looking at the Azure Functions operations. And if that shows the same thing, then we can really say that the performance has been improving on the Azure Functions runtime. So I need to do a bit more data searching and cleaning, and then have some more results on that. But I found this quite interesting. Then cost, always a big factor, but not for this. I'm only running this function every other hour, so there's not a lot happening there. On the other side, it is using durable functions. So a durable function consists of a client function, an orchestrator function, and several activity functions. So there are quite a bit more functions involved than if you are not using durable functions. And durable functions also uses table storage, queue storage, and some blob storage under the hood. So you'll also be paying a bit more storage-wise. But again, it is a regular storage account, so it's still very cheap. So if I look back for 1 year, it's slightly over €8. So I'm definitely not worried about that. You can definitely see quite a steep increase here between May and June. I think that is because I added a lot more repositories to process. I think I also did quite a bit more there on the whole logging and alerting part. So as you can see here, if you look at the meters, so almost half of it I'm spending on log analytics. So I can definitely reduce that a bit now since it's running more smoothly. So final slide, just to give you a hint of what's possible and how quick you can have, let's say, a minimum viable product running in production. So this only cost me 5 evenings of work. So I think it's seven commits and to have my first version up and running. It's not all the code that you've seen before. So I incremented quite a bit over time, but my initial version was great just in a couple of evenings of work, which is, I think, quite nice of medium code solutions. I think Azure Functions is a good example of a medium code solution, where you can use these extensions and bindings and triggers quite easily without writing a lot of code. So if you're interested in Azure Functions, then yeah, make sure you actually follow the AGFunk Updates Twitter account, so you'll be notified of all of the updates. And if you want to learn more about Azure Functions, then definitely have a look at that link below. That's a link to my YouTube channel. It contains stuff about Jewel Functions and also Azure Functions University. And like I said before, if you want to help me out with writing content for Azure Functions University, I'll be very happy to accept that as well. Thanks all.
Thank you, Mark. Yeah, you definitely went into the monitoring there. That's great. I saw you followed the chat while you're doing the talk. So
not everything, but sometimes. Yeah.
I saw there was a request for demo, but I guess like the whole solution is the demo. So that kind of answers that question. Otherwise, I don't think there's anything else from the chat that needs to be brought up. But a lot of thanks. Good praises for you. That's always nice. I have a question.
Sure.
So you showed that average response time metric alert.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a metric alert, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, indeed.
And if you would wanna have an alert that doesn't adhere to cold starts, how would you prevent that? Because if the function is idle for more than 20 minutes, I guess it is, mm-hmm, then there's a longer response time.
So the initial one will always be triggering and you are not interested in that, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, that is a good one. Mm. Yeah. Yeah, because the first time it executes, then any of those functions will have an initial execution time, so it will always be then bad for that first one.
Yeah, the alert will be triggered every time it's
a downtime. I don't think that's easily fixed on the alerting side there. It sounds then you would like to go a bit fancier and have something then doing something with the alerts, so that whenever an alert comes in, you need some more logic there to detect, okay, is this the first thing and the first execution or something, or
exactly like
to do more of an aggregation on it. I mean, you can do aggregations on in alerts themselves, to be honest. But yeah, in this case, I don't see a really quick solution for that.
No, okay. Yeah, that's something I'm thinking about at the moment.
Mm.
We also had a question here about some security. Do you have any best practices or advices?
Right.
Guess the background there is that functions, they have a public endpoint. And
Exactly. Yeah. No, yeah, if you're really cautious about it, and I'm now working for a client who is quite cautious about it, you should use a running in a VNet, which means then you should use premium functions. And you can also use private endpoints then, so then things are not accessible publicly at all anymore. But yeah, that's really quite a price increment then. So for the consumption model, yeah, the best thing you can do is you need to have these keys. I think you can also have some IP limitations as well, I think, still in the consumption mode.
If you would look at the whole security narrative going from the security by identity, then you would probably have to do something there. But you could also put the functions behind an application gateway, I guess.
Definitely. Yeah. If you're working with HTTP function, definitely in the gateway. Yes.
Yeah. And then you could have an API manager instead of
that. Yeah. Oh, definitely. Yeah, indeed. Yeah. Now I would never expose my direct HTTP endpoints for my function to the public. So definitely API management is a good solution there. And that's also available now as a serverless offering as well. So you're not paying the full price when you just want to either have a small solution or just playing around with it. That's definitely recommended. Yeah.
Yeah. I also seen that there's some public previews about identity-based connections for the SDK.
I think it was announced just like last week or something, indeed. Yeah. Also, when it comes to the storage accounts now.
Yeah.
I think that's indeed a very welcome solution. Indeed, it's been asked for quite a while. So everything is more moving to these identity-based connections, which is good. So we can drop all of the weird connection-based, connection string-based access. Yeah.
Great. Do you have any last tips? I mean, going to Functions Academy, I guess, is a good tip.
Yeah, if your needs still very new in Functions anyway, then Azure Functions University is indeed, I think, a good starting point. Also, Microsoft, I think, has some quite nice learning paths which you can follow as well. I think it's also, when you really are starting with serverless, you usually also need to think a bit differently about your architecture as well. It's not like writing your average web application or console application or something like that. State management becomes more and more important. And there are some things which can help you with that, such as durable functions. It's very important to realize that you probably need to also program a bit differently than you used before.
Do you have any good examples about that?
Yeah, well, one of it has to do with scale. Eh? So especially the consumption plan can scale like crazy. But if you're inserting objects in your SQL database, which is a very tiny database, then you'll DDoS your database and you won't be able to do anything at all anymore. So that's what I mean with you have to probably do a bit of if you're going for an existing solution and rewriting that as a serverless solution, you can't simply do a one-to-one translation usually. So you really have to think about more event-driven solutions and using asynchronous solutions, more messaging-based solutions than direct calls to database and things like that. Because not everything in your solution will probably scale as well as your functions will do.
And also, there's... Since you pay per execution, then you might want to think about the cost of memory consumption, the compute cost. You could probably do a lot of stuff to optimize just because of cost, not because of performance.
That's all true, as always, it's a bit of a trade-off. Eh? So especially if you're doing very large volumes of things, then the consumption model might be a very bad idea because you might spend a lot of money on that, so then you might be very well better off either in a premium SKU or like a full app service SKU in detail. So there's all kinds of considerations in detail. So and the consumption plan is very easy to get started with, but it's not necessarily the best solution.
Okay. Yeah. I'm just reading the chat here if there's anything else. There was good interaction in the chat today. I really like that.
Perfect. Yeah, cool.
Yeah. So functions is hot. So great. Big thank you, Mark. I appreciate you taking your time to do this. And just as a closing note, we would want to thank everyone that would join today. Please join the meetup if you want to be notified for other events in the future. Join the Discord, of course. Maybe we are lucky that Mark joins it and can answer some serverless discussions.
I'll join. Yeah, I'll join.
I didn't want to put you on the spot.
It's okay.
Yeah, the YouTube, if you search for Ashes Corner, we will be posting this there because we couldn't live stream it today, and it's probably due to the big Fastly outage that was happened today. And thanks to everyone that was sharing their attendance on social media for Ashes Corner. We should have had an a badge sent to us, so you would have been able to claim it, but it's going to be for next time, so it wasn't delivered actually, so next time we'll get it. But with that, yeah, thank you for today, and have a great evening, everyone.
Cool. Bye-bye.
Bye.